May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Good morning and welcome to our service of worship on this fourth Sunday in Easter. If you will turn with me to the back of your bulletins, we have several important announcements we need to work our way through before we begin. Now please note that our worship next Sunday will be at 11 instead of 9:30. So what's that? 11. I got it right this time. I didn't get it right this morning, but I got it right now. So next Sunday, we will be worshiping here at 11. This Wednesday evening at 6:30, we will be having a joint congregational meeting or a town hall meeting with the Trinity folk at their sanctuary at 6:30 to kind of just start discussing how we can start doing more things together. So everyone is invited to attend. It doesn't matter if you're an elder or a deacon or just a member or just a guest. If you want to come and be a part of that, again, this Wednesday, 6:30 in the sanctuary at Trinity, and Trinity's congregation will be there as well. You can see the upcoming committee meetings. If you're interested in joining Eastside and being part of the new member class, please speak with me. You can see the knitting group and the rummage sale and the Bible studies, all of those events that are going on. Please note, we are still collecting the shoes to contribute to the First Presbyterian Shoe Drive. Any questions or comments, please speak with Edie, who is in charge of pretty much everything. I do have one announcement, and that is that this is Patty Kennedy, who is the daughter of Jesse Haas, has passed away. Jesse's address is in our directory, so if we could keep the family of Patty Kennedy in our prayers. Are there any other announcements that I have missed or anyone would like to remind us of or add? Okay, so as our prelude music is played, as our candles are lit, let us focus our heads and our hearts on the Word of God. If you are able, would you stand and join with me in our call to worship this morning? I was overjoyed when they said to me,
"Let us go to the house of the Lord."
Like faithful people of old, this is where we learn God's ways,
that we may walk in His paths.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you sent Jesus, our good shepherd, to gather us together. May we not wander from His flock, but follow wherever He leads us. listening for his voice, and staying near him until we are safely in your fold to live with you forever. We pray this through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. In the grace of God, we can now confess our sins to God. Would you all please join with me in our unison prayer of confession in our bulletins? Let us pray. Almighty God, in raising Jesus from the grave, you shattered the power of sin and death. We confess that we remain captive to doubt and fear, bound by the ways that lead to death. We overlook the poor and the hungry, and pass by those who mourn. We are deaf to the cries of the oppressed, and indifferent to calls for peace. We despise the weak, and abuse the earth you made. Forgive us, God of mercy. Help us to trust your power to change our lives and make us new, that we may know the joy of life abundant given in Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with all the saints. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Share the peace with those that are around us.
I lay it all down.
you join me in prayer? Let us pray. O living God, with joy we celebrate the presence of your risen word. Enliven our hearts by the Holy Spirit, so that we may proclaim the good news of eternal and abundant life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Our Old Testament lesson is from the familiar Psalm 23, page 862 in your Bibles and from the New International Version. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely your goodness and your love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle lesson is from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 19 through 25 on page 1889 in your pew Bibles. For it is commendable if someone bears up under the pain of unjust suffering because they are conscious of God. But how is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it? But if you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God. To this you were called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you were like sheep going astray, but now you have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. This is the word of our Lord.
Our gospel reading is taken from the Gospel of John in the 10th chapter, beginning in the first verse. I tell you the truth. The person who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. But the person who enters by the gate is the shepherd of his sheep. The watchman opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize the stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but they did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, I tell you the truth. I am the gate for the sheep. All who ever came before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in, and he will go out, and they will find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it in abundance. This all is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Apparently, when you go on cruises, you're supposed to stay up really late and go to the midnight buffet. As if you didn't already have like six buffets throughout the day before, you're supposed to stay up really late and go to the midnight buffet because apparently there's only things at this one that there aren't at any of the other ones. Okay, so the first night we are on our cruise, we sleep in late, we get up because we know we're going to stay late, we go to the midnight buffet, and there literally is everything you could possibly imagine that you want to eat. Well, you want chicken. Good, because there's 10 chicken dishes for you to choose from. Right? You want steak. You want prime rib. You want roast beef. Good, there's 10 different varieties of it. You want fish. You want lobster. Great, because it's cooked every way imaginable. If you want a salad, you can have mine. Because I'm not going and eating from the salad portion of the midnight buffet. My wife can have whatever she wants. But if you want a salad, there is every type of lettuce imaginable. And then there's dessert. You want pie? There's 10 different pies. You want cake? 10 different cakes. You want things you never even knew you wanted? Great, because there's a whole table full of that stuff to try. There was wine, there was beer, there was a bar, there was whatever you wanted to drink. I have never seen so much food in my life. I have never eaten so much food in my life. And the best part, you got to do it the next night at the next midnight buffet. But if you can imagine the midnight buffet on a cruise, and there certainly was not lacking anything, any kind of food that you could imagine, you wouldn't go and miss something because they had it all. If you could think of it, some poor chef had to cook it. But if you can understand not wanting or lacking at a buffet, you can understand what it means to be the sheep of God. Because the psalmist says, I shall not want. I shall not be lacking anything because the Lord is my shepherd. You can go to the buffet and find everything you can imagine to be the sheep of God, to be the sheep of Yahweh, to be the sheep of the Lord means that you have the fullness of God because God gives of God's very own self and being to all of his sheep. They're not lacking anything because God chooses to give it. They aren't needing anything or wanting anything because the Lord provides it in abundance. This is why the psalmist says, I shall not want. Everything else in this very familiar psalm are all the things that the sheep enjoy. The blessings and the kinds of blessings and the very things and abundance that God chooses to give to them. But yet, we need to remember, we never lack anything. We shall not want for anything. In whatever our circumstances are, whatever our situations are, whatever our struggles, our ages, our difficulties, our joys, and our blessings, we lack for nothing because God is our shepherd. But what does it mean to lie down in green pastures? What does it mean to be able to walk beside the still waters? Well, these pastures and these still waters are the places where the sheep sleep and relax and are refreshed. So the first thing that the psalmist says that the sheep, the people of God, are never wanting for is a place of rest, a place of refreshment, a place where they can sleep and relax, green pastures and still waters. Well, this is something that we do not lack, but is it something that we really enjoy? Do we take moments to rest? Do we have places to be refreshed? Do we take care of ourselves and give ourselves the moments to rest in our green pastures, to walk beside our still waters? And if you're like me, the answer is we don't. Because we go, and we go some more. And we have a long list of things that we need to do, want to do, or voluntold to do if you're married. That's a joke, folks, stay with me. But we are a culture of achievers, and doers, and go-getters. We are a people of ambition, and yet the psalmist says, we shall not lack green pastures and still waters. So do you give yourself a day, a time to rest and to have Sabbath in your green pastures beside your still waters? God has given you a place of refreshment. Can you give yourself time and space to be refreshed? The psalmist then says, he restores my soul, he leads me on the right tracks for his name's sake. So what the psalmist says they're not lacking is forgiveness. To be restored in one's soul is to be forgiven and renewed and to be refreshed. So which of any of God's people in any time and any place lack the forgiving grace of Almighty God? He restoreth my soul. But friends, if God gives you forgiveness, can you give yourself forgiveness? Can you give your neighbor forgiveness? Can you give your brother or sister the very forgiveness that God gives? If God is restoring your soul and the soul of all the sheep, can you be God better by leaving them on the hook? By holding them accountable? If God gives forgiveness, if we as a people are not lacking forgiveness, then why is it so hard for church people to forgive ourselves, each other, the person in front of you or behind you? God restores our soul. Why won't we let our souls be restored, or the souls of each other? We shall not want, the psalmist says, and yet we want and lack forgiveness. But he also says he leads me on the right tracks. It literally means wagon tracks. So it doesn't just mean that we are a forgiven people, but we also are a guided people. There's also a way that has already been made. In the ancient world, the roads had the ruts in them. So all you had to do to stay on the road was follow the ruts. Well, the psalmist says we do not lack the wagon ruts of righteousness to follow. The road has already been made and paved. We all just have to follow it. So not only are we forgiven, he restores our soul, but he leads us on the right track, all for his name's sake. And every time we fail, we have another chance to walk and come back to the right track, the tracks of righteousness. So not only are we not lacking green pastures and still waters, we are also not lacking forgiveness and second chances. This is God's midnight buffet. But the psalmist isn't finished. He says, even though I walk through the darkest valley, or you could translate it, the valley of the shadow of death, the whole point is we all have our fear moments. We all have those moments when we are surrounded and we are absolutely terrified, either by going to the grave or burying someone we know or love, or being absolutely terrified of the situation or the temptation. We all have had and will have dark valley moments. Perhaps that's even one of these moments now, where we are walking through Death Valley. But the psalmist says, even there, we are not lacking courage. I will fear no evil, because the shepherd is always with the sheep. And the shepherd's rod and the shepherd's crook, they comfort me. So we are not lacking places of rest. We are not lacking forgiveness. We are not lacking second chances. But it also means we are not lacking companionship. We are never alone if we are the sheep with the divine shepherd. Even in the dark places and the dark moments, even in the graves, we are never alone. And we are not lacking courage. So that means that even in your dark valleys, when you must walk and you are not alone, it means that you have someone protecting you. But friends, it doesn't mean that you will never have a dark valley to walk through. It means you have a way through the dark valleys. It means you will never be afraid. It means you have a way through it, a way to get through it, to bear the unbearable things that lie in the valleys of the shadow of death. It means you are not lacking a way through, but you are also not lacking the courage to walk through it. Because God, shepherd, will never leave the sheep. So if this is a dark valley moment for you, you can walk it, because you're not lacking the courage needed to walk through it, but you also have a companion to walk through it with you, God. And if God is your shepherd, you can go through the dark valleys. But the psalmist continues. He also says that you've got a banquet. You've got a banquet, a table that God prepares in the midst of your enemies. And when you have a banquet, everyone is anointed and prepared and dressed for that banquet. So God not only throws a party surrounded by the wolves for the sheep of God, but God actually dresses and prepares and gets the sheep ready for the party. So you anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Has there ever been a moment when you or we feel like we are the sheep surrounded by wolves? And even there, we are still not lacking or wanting for anything, because we have the great banquet God to be anointed with overflowing abundance to share with each other. And that means that even when surrounded by those who wish you harm, those that wish to destroy you, you still have the great banquet that God provides. And if God provides it, you have the midnight buffet where nothing will ever be lacking. Surely you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Even when we are surrounded by wolves, the shepherd's still caring and providing for his sheep. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. I can remember a cartoon, Looney Tunes, where they have the foxes being hunted by the incompetent dogs, right? And the whole point is you've got the men on the horse that are trying to hunt down the fox, and the dogs are running them, and the fox is smart, so the dogs are going this way, the fox is going this way, but the whole point is they hunted and chased down the fox. Everybody with me? Do you realize that if you are the sheep of God, God is pursuing you? The shepherd pursuing you, like the men pursuing the fox. Surely goodness and mercy shall hunt you down all the days of your life. That's what it means to be the sheep of God, to be pursued. Because you know what? Sheep run off. Disciples run off. We get impulsive and distracted and even flat out rebelling. But the psalmist says, surely goodness and mercy shall pursue me all the days of my life. It means that even when we lose ourselves, even when we fall into bad habits, bad attitudes, and bad ideas, we do not lack for a shepherd. And a shepherd will always pursue the lost sheep. And because it's God, do we really think God will ever lose a single person? No. Because we do not lack a shepherd. Every time we go astray, God will pursue us, not to smack us around, but with goodness and with steadfast love shall follow me 5 minutes, 5 hours, all the days of my life. So the simple truth, friends, is that Jesus is going to pursue you, and you will be with God forever. He's not going to lose you. He's not capable of losing you, even when you lose yourself. Even when it's we are the ones that run off, can we really imagine a place or a situation or a context where he can't find us and he can't bring us home? Surely goodness and mercy shall pursue me all the days of my life. Friends, what if the kingdom of God is exactly like a midnight buffet that lacks nothing? A sheep, a people, a flock that lack nothing, because God is their shepherd to provide and to protect them, even if it's from themselves. So the psalmist says, I shall not lack anything. And what that means for us is that y'all got green pastures and still waters. But at some point, maybe you should stop and rest by them instead of continually going over and over and over again. It means you have forgiveness for your sins and another chance and another chance. But if we are forgiven, shouldn't we learn to forgive? Shouldn't we learn to take that second chance and to make the most of it? But if we lack for nothing, it means that you have companionship and you have protection even in death valleys and in dark places. and you can walk without fearing anything. But it also means that if we lack nothing, even when we are surrounded, we still have the banquet of God, where we are anointed, where our cup overflows. But it means, friends, that if we truly lack nothing, when we run off, when we lose ourselves, when we go astray, when we are distracted and find ourselves following the wrong impulses, we can remember that we are not lacking the shepherd who goes and pursues the sheep. And that means that goodness and steadfast love will never be lacking for you. But friends, if this is your shepherd that gives everything so that you shall not lack, shouldn't you trust in him? Shouldn't you follow him? Shouldn't at some point you start running off, making him coming after you for the thousandth time? But because if you are truly lacking for nothing, shouldn't you love him like he loves you? So you have a shepherd, friends, to provide and to protect you. Do as the psalmist says, trust and follow your shepherd. Trust and follow in Jesus, and you will live. God has prepared the midnight buffet, friends. Let's all stay awake and enjoy it, because we lack nothing. Amen.
Thank you.
We have sung to God our praises. Let us give to God now an affirmation of our faith found printed in our bulletins this morning. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess to the glory of God, Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. Would you all please be seated? It is only in the blessed hope of the resurrection that we are able to pray to the Lord of endless life. So this morning I would like us to do prayers that are responsive. So I am going to say, by your grace, O God, and I would like you to respond with, raise us from death to life. So by your grace, O God, raise us from death to life. Let us pray. We remember, O God, that Jesus is our shepherd, and therefore we truly lack nothing. Therefore we pause now in the midst of our day and our worship to offer our intercessions for your people. We pray for all your children that need the refreshment of lying in green pastures and the security of being led by still waters. By your grace, O God, raise us from death to life. For all your children, O God, that need the returning of their souls in forgiveness and another chance to walk in the wagon tracks of righteousness for your namesake. By your grace, O God, raise us from death to life. For all your children, O God, that walk through the valley of death, or the deepest darkness, help them to fear no evil, because you are with us. Grant to your children the comfort of your rod and staff in protection. By your grace, O God, raise us from death to life. For all your children, O God, surrounded by enemies and those that are hostile to them, prepare once again your banquet table. Anoint their heads in oil and overflow their cups. By your grace, O God, raise us from death to life. O God, for all your children that are lost or alone, pursue them with your goodness and with your steadfast love all the days of their lives. By your grace, O God, raise us from death to life. We pray, O God, for all your children to return and remain in your house all the length of our days. By your grace, O God, raise us from death to life. Eternal God, show forth in us and in our world the good news of your saving power and love. so that all may believe and have life in you. Hear us now as we pray the prayer your Son has taught us to pray, as we all say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The Lord is our shepherd. We truly lack for nothing. But now is the time of our worship for us to give back to God the first fruits of those many blessings. So as our usher brings forth our gifts, let us offer together our lives in gratitude to God. If you are able, would you stand as we sing together the doxology? Of your grace. Receive, we pray, with these gifts and offerings, our love and our devotion, and use them and us for the sake of your eternal glory and the advancement of your kingdom, both here and now and in the world to come. We pray in the name of the risen Christ. Amen. time of our worship is over. But that only means that the time of our work is once again upon us. So we bid you now to go out into the world ever mindful, that because the Lord Jesus is our shepherd, we truly lack for nothing. But as his sheep, let us trust in the shepherd's care and protection all the days of our lives. And now it is unto the tenderest mercies of Almighty God that we now commend you. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you this day and unto ages of ages. And everyone says,
Amen.